In 1962, Stan Lee and Steve Ditko were working together on a Marvel Comics magazine scheduled to be canceled within its 15th issue. With nothing to lose and nothing to prove, the two decided to debut a new character in Amazing Fantasy number 15, Spider-Man. The book, starring a nerdy teenager who gained superpowers after being bitten by a radioactive spider, turned out to be one of the most successful comics Marvel had ever sold. Since then, Spider-Man has become one of the most enduring characters in American pop culture. Not only that, but Spidey's also managed to find more success in video games than most, if not all, of his superhero peers. When Lee and Ditko introduced Spider-Man and his alter ego Peter Parker, readers identified with the character and his story almost immediately. Part of this was because he had so much in common with the adolescent audience that shared his adventures: young, misunderstood, and trying to find a place in the world. But his real-life relatable problems weren't all that had readers hooked. Spider-Man had a unique set of powers and a distinctive look that set him apart from the other superheroes on the newsstand. Unlike other comic book heroes, Spider-Man's face was completely covered. Anyone could have been under that mask. It's been said that readers are better able to identify with the character because of this visual anonymity. While the decision to completely conceal Spider-Man's identity may not have been deliberately done for this effect, it's likely that it helped make Spider-Man the perfect superpowered stand-in for players wanting to immerse themselves in his video game adventures. But it would be a while after Spider-Man's introduction in the early 1960s for him to swing into the digital world. In the intervening years, Spider-Man appeared on television in cartoons and live-action series. By the early 1980s, Marvel Comics had learned the value of licensing its characters into other media. So when video games began to gain in popularity, the company saw an opportunity. In 1981, Parker Brothers snapped up licenses to make video games based on Star Wars, Care Bears, and Marvel's Spider-Man. A year later, the company released Spider-Man for the Atari 2600. Despite its hardware limitations, the game still managed to provide players with a relatively authentic Spider-Man experience. Spidey crawled up the side of a building and defused bombs set by his arch-nemesis, the Green Goblin. Players could even swing from webs while trying to avoid the Goblin's webline-cutting thugs in the building's windows. According to a 2005 interview with Laura Nikolich, the lead programmer on the project, she and her team were free to make the game they wanted to create, within the limits of the system's capabilities, of course. Quote, "No one ever told me how to do a Spider-Man. We had a few conversations with the marketing people, but we would just explain the limitations of the system, and then we'd get our way. They gave us a bunch of comic books, which I read, but I knew Spider-Man. I'd seen the cheesy afternoon shows. So it really wasn't too hard to come up with the game." End quote. Despite Marvel's lack of input on the title, Nikolich and her team managed to come up with an inspired choice for the game's antagonist, the Green Goblin. It turns out the decision was made mostly for technical reasons. Nikolich said that the Goblin, quote, "was the easiest to do because he could fly." All in all, the Atari 2600 game wasn't a bad debut for the webbed wonder. The game was enough of a success that Marvel wanted to put more of their characters into players' hands. For that, they tapped Scott Adams. Adams was a programmer whose company, Adventure International, was making a name for itself in the burgeoning computer game industry. Marvel and Adventure International inked a deal for the developer to create 12 new text-based games based on Marvel characters, and Marvel would also publish tie-in comic books that fleshed out what happened in the games. Adams explains how the arrangement came about in an email interview with Machinima. Quote, "We were contacted by Joe Calamari at Marvel. He was the vice president at the time and later became president of Marvel. He was always looking for new tie-ins for Marvel characters. He wanted to get Marvel into computer gaming, and it appears my name and my company came highly recommended as the place to go." In 1984, Adventure International released Quest Probe Spider-Man, the second in the series after the company had published its first Quest Probe game starring the Incredible Hulk. The text-based adventure game was paired with static images that changed based on the player's in-game actions, which were drawn by actual Marvel Comics artists. Quote, "All the artwork for the characters in-game was set up by Marvel and then transferred by my artist into the game engine or approved by Marvel when we made changes," end quote, recalls Adams. The programmer also served as plotter for the published Quest Probe comics. Quote, "I did the complete storylines for the tie-in comic books, and then they storyboarded them. I approved them, and then they went to final creation," end quote. In the game, Spider-Man was sent on a puzzle-solving, gem-hunting expedition by a brand new villain named Chief Examiner. The villain wasn't just created by Adams, though. He actually was Adams. Adams explains how Marvel decided on the Examiner's unique design. Quote, "The Chief Examiner was going to appear throughout the series. When asked how I wanted him to look, I said, model him on me. Marvel asked me to send in a picture, and they would discuss it. When I heard back, they said, yeah, you look evil enough." End quote. While it might not impress modern gamers, Quest Probe included many of Spidey's signature villains, as well as his powers, like his spider strength and the ability to crawl on the ceiling. However, the action never took the hero to the New York City skyline, a pretty important part of the character's stories and a prominent feature in the Atari 2600 outing from 1982. Much like the Parker Brothers game, though, technical limitations dictated certain creative decisions, like setting the game indoors. "I had to put Spider-Man inside," says Adams, as his travel abilities would mean folks would be trying to take off in all directions. Ultimately, despite the game's positive reception, Adventure International couldn't stay in business as tastes in video games shifted away from text-based adventures. The company folded in 1985 with only three of the Marvel games made. Spider-Man wouldn't make his way back to video games for another 5 years. In 1989, Marvel's license went to a computer game publisher named Paragon Software. Paragon managed to release only two games featuring the character, a 1989 team-up called Spider-Man and Captain America in Doctor Doom's Revenge, and 1990's The Amazing Spider-Man. Both improved on gameplay elements featured in previous Spidey titles, like acrobatics and wall-crawling skills. Yet neither one was able to offer gamers the same kind of experience seen in the comics. In Doctor Doom's Revenge, players switched off between the two titular characters and fought villains one-on-one. But while some villains like the Rhino or Machete appeared, there were some odd choices of antagonists too. At one point, Spider-Man takes on a robot. Shortly thereafter, Captain America tussles with a gorilla. Needless to say, the game's devotion to comic book continuity didn't seem to be much of a priority. In The Amazing Spider-Man, the hero had to infiltrate Mysterio's hideout in an effort to rescue his wife, Mary Jane. Even though Spidey's wall-crawling and web-swinging powers were on full display, he never threw a punch, lacking any offensive moves. The emphasis here was on the hero using his agility to solve puzzles and make it to the end of the game in one piece. After these two entries, Paragon didn't publish any more Spider-Man titles. As Marvel entered the 1990s, the great American comic book boom was waiting right around the corner. In addition, it was becoming clear that home consoles were beating computers in the battle for video game dominance. Soon, kids everywhere would be inundated with more superheroes than ever before, in four-color funny books, on Saturday morning cartoons, and, of course, on video game consoles. But how much Spider-Man is too much? Fans were about to find out. As the 1990s began, comic books were a cash cow. Business for Marvel and their publishing rivals DC Comics had been picking up steam since the late 80s. Collectors and speculators flocked to comic book shops to grab every new number one issue they could find, hoping valuable comics would pay for their kids' college funds. In 1991, Marvel released X-Men number one from Chris Claremont and Jim Lee. The issue became the highest selling comic book of all time, moving over 8.1 million copies and generating almost $7 million for the publisher. It was a watershed moment for the industry, and today can be seen as the official birth of the comic book boom. But by the middle of the decade, the industry would go from boom to bust in a spectacular fashion, taking the web wall crawler with it. Marvel's flagship character Spider-Man was just as caught up in the comics explosion of the 90s as the X-Men. From 1990 to 1996, there would be 11 video games with the character's name in the title, not counting ports, handheld Tiger Electronic games, or Capcom's infamous Fighters featuring Marvel characters. While a few of these titles brought gamers closer to the experiences they'd read about in comics, many were simply rehashes of what had come before. Spider-Man's video game saturation started small, with Nintendo's handheld Game Boy system. Marvel forged an agreement with acclaimed subsidiary LJN to handle the character's appearances on Nintendo's family of consoles. So for their first game, The Amazing Spider-Man, LJN tapped developer Rare Limited. If the name sounds familiar, it should. A few years later, Rare would become the company behind the Super Nintendo hit Donkey Kong Country and the legendary GoldenEye 007 for the Nintendo 64. While Amazing Spider-Man never gained such celebrated status as those games, Rare infused it with an understanding of Spider-Man's powers that hadn't been seen in Spidey titles up to that point. Spider-Man fought several villains from his rogue gallery in this action side-scroller, including Hobgoblin, Scorpion, Mysterio, and more. His powers were also better represented, featuring spider strength and agility, not to mention his trademark web-slinging. Gameplay also shifted between fighting in Manhattan streets and subways to building crawling segments reminiscent of 1982's Atari 2600 installment. The character's spider sense also made its first appearance in an action game. While climbing to the top of the building, players were warned of incoming danger. With tons of action and a constant barrage of foes, Rare's title offered players a pretty authentic Spidey experience, considering the comic's high stakes and non-stop action. It's not surprising that Rare made such a great Spider-Man game, considering their quality track record in the years to come. However, LJN went a different route with the two sequels they published for the Game Boy in 1992 and 1993. For Amazing Spider-Man 2 and Spider-Man 3 Invasion of the Spider-Slayers, LJN chose Bit Studios. These sequels offered some new mechanics, like wall-crawling abilities throughout whole levels and being able to enter and explore buildings in an almost open-world style. But ultimately, the 2-bit's installments weren't nearly as polished or fun to play as the ones that spawned the Game Boy trilogy. Nintendo's chief rival during the early 90s was Sega, and in 1990 they published the first Spider-Man game for their 8-bit Master System, with a port to the Sega Genesis console coming a year later in 1991. Called The Amazing Spider-Man vs. the Kingpin, it was the first project taken on by developer Technopop, a company that was also the first independent American developer for the Genesis. Technopop's title brought even more of the character's unique qualities to the video game world. In addition to fluid acrobatics and action-packed fisticuffs, Spider-Man vs. the Kingpin was the first game to incorporate aspects of Spider-Man's alter ego, Peter Parker. In order to earn money and buy supplies for web fluid, players could equip Spider-Man with his camera and sell photographs of villains Spidey encountered. Taking photos of bad guys helped clear Spider-Man's name within the context of the story, but from a gameplay standpoint, the mechanic offered players the most faithful representation of the character yet. The game was a hit. According to Randall Rice, Technopop's founder, over two-thirds of the Genesis' entire install base bought it. In fact, Rice said it was such a huge success that Marvel Comics reversed course on a decision to pull its property license deal with Sega. The publisher took advantage of that license again in 1991, releasing a coin-operated arcade game aptly named Spider-Man: The Video Game. A four-player cooperative beat-em-up in the style of Capcom's Final Fight, Sega's game was plenty fun and had some impressive visuals and animations for the time, including a memorable scene where Spider-Man's villain Venom grew to gigantic proportions. But beyond the game's title and a few of its characters, it didn't have much to do with the character in terms of gameplay. Each of the four characters was more or less interchangeable, and only one of them, Black Cat, could be considered a cast member of Spider-Man's adventures. And the Submariner was an undersea prince. Needless to say, he and Spidey didn't cross paths too often. It wasn't apparent at the time, but Sega's coin-op arcade game marked the beginning of the end for innovation in Spider-Man's games. Once it was clear that kids would buy anything called Spider-Man, the effort to make his games push the boundaries of what had gone before disappeared. The deluge of uninspired and cloned games was about to commence. In 1992, LJN relied on Bits once again to make the first and only game starring the character on the Nintendo Entertainment System, Spider-Man: Return of the Sinister Six. Much like Bits' efforts on the Game Boy, this was a somewhat lackluster action side-scroller. The same year, LJN worked with Software Creations to put out yet another action side-scroller, Spider-Man X-Men: Arcade's Revenge, for the Sega Genesis and Super Nintendo. Arcade's Revenge was a team-up game where players controlled one cast member at a time while trying to survive Arcade's death traps. The team-up aspect was spiritually similar to 1989's computer game Spider-Man and Captain America in Doctor Doom's Revenge. Revenge was clearly a popular theme. By this point, the age of comic book excess was in full swing. Superman was killed in 1992, and Batman's back was broken in 1993. Massive events and shakeups were the recipe to drive up sales, and Spider-Man was no exception. In 1993, Marvel published a story arc in which Spidey teamed up with his opposite number, Venom, to take down their common enemy, the murderous Carnage. If Venom was basically an evil extreme version of Spidey, then Carnage was an evil extreme version of Venom, an example of too much of a good thing, if there ever was one. So it was fitting that at the height of the boom in 1994, LJN and Software Creations released Spider-Man and Venom: Maximum Carnage for the Super Nintendo and Genesis consoles. Another Final Fight-style beat-em-up, the game itself wasn't anything special. But it was notable for being the first video game based on a specific comic storyline, something of a rarity even today. Symbolically, though, it encapsulated the Boom era's spirit because of the overall package. The cartridges manufactured by LJN were blood red. Colored cartridges were basically the video game equivalent of gold holofoil comics. Impressive on the surface, but more flash than function. Unsurprisingly, the red cartridge is what's best remembered about this game today. The soundtrack composed by the forgettable alternative band Green Jelly didn't hurt its 90s-esque legacy either. LJN's corporate parent Acclaim teamed up with Software Creations in 1995 to release yet another game based on a comic story. Venom, Spider-Man, Separation Anxiety. While its cartridge wasn't colored, it still managed to multiply the extreme factor. Instead of fighting just Carnage, this time Spider-Man and Venom took on 5 more spider symbiotes. A year after that, Acclaim published a game based on Spider-Man the Animated Series, which itself was based on the comics. Overall, it was more of the same, and by this point, Acclaim's Spider-Man franchise suffered from overexposure and lack of originality. The animated series would be the publisher's last title with the license. In 1996, Sega published Spider-Man Web of Fire for their short-lived 32-bit Genesis add-on, the 32X. The system tanked, and the game failed to gain an audience. Today, it's one of the rarest Spider-Man games, and it's highly sought after by collectors, mainly because no one bought it the first time around, and it's hard to find. Web of Fire would be the final Spider-Man game of the century. Marvel filed for bankruptcy in December of 1996. By the mid-90s, the comic book industry had collapsed, a victim of its own excesses. Speculators realized that the comics they'd collected were barely worth the prices printed on the covers, and largely stopped buying. Spider-Man fell victim to the industry's pursuit of style over substance, caught up in the Clone Saga from 1994 to 1996. The arc featured a never-ending cast of Spider-Man's genetic duplicates, a nonsensical storyline, and the ire of fans who'd been reading for years. Both in comics and in video games, Spider-Man's endless clones drove fans away and tarnished what had been one of Marvel's best brands. It would take a miracle to make Spider-Man interesting to fans again. Well, a miracle, or a brand new video game system. As the 21st century began, Marvel Comics was reinventing itself. It had climbed out of its financial ruin by the mid-90s with big-budget hit movies based on its characters like Blade in 1998 and X-Men in 2000. Marvel was finding more success outside of comics publishing as a license-generating engine, pushing its properties into other media like television, film, and video games with renewed focus. As the company prepared for the cinematic debut of Spider-Man in 2002, a film that had been in development hell for nearly 25 years, it was time to bring the wall crawler back to the spotlight. It's fitting then that Sony, whose Sony Pictures subsidiary, would finally put him on the big screen and would be instrumental in staging the character's triumphant return to the world of gaming. Spider-Man hadn't starred in his own game since 1996 forgettable adventure for Sega's 32X, Web of Fire. By 1999, Activision had gotten the license from Marvel and tapped its internal studio, Neversoft, to develop a new game for Sony's PlayStation console, which was nearing the end of its life cycle. Neversoft had comics in its DNA. The studio was founded at the height of the comics boom in 1994 by former programmers of Malibu Interactive, the video game division of Malibu Comics. Malibu was eventually acquired by none other than Marvel, but not before Chris Ward, Joel Jewett, and Mick West could form their independent development studio, which itself was bought by Activision in 1999. In fact, in 1996, the company worked for 6 months on a game based on another Marvel character, Ghost Rider, for Crystal Dynamics. That wound up canceled. It might have been Neversoft's destiny to work on a game for Marvel's flagship character, or maybe getting the Spider-Man assignment from Activision was just another in a string of marvelous coincidences. Whatever the case, for Neversoft to fully master the ways of the spider, first it needed to get some help from a different animal, the Hawk. The studio's in-house game engine had been evolving since 1996, when it was created for a game called Big Guns that never saw release. In 1998, Neversoft used the engine in a game called Apocalypse, which didn't tear up the charts despite featuring the voice talents of Bruce Willis. But while Willis couldn't sell gamers on Apocalypse, he could sell Tony Hawk on Neversoft. Activision assigned the studio the task of making a skateboarding game, so the studio rewrote the Apocalypse engine's physics and controls. Skateboarding legend Tony Hawk had been visiting different companies about licensing his likeness for a video game. And when he met with Neversoft, Hawk ended up face to face with a digital Bruce. said studio co-founder Joel Jewett in 2004, the first demo, the one we showed to Tony Hawk to get him on board, had Bruce Willis on a skateboard. He was still holding a gun, I think. Even with Bruce packing heat, Hawk was impressed with what he saw, and Activision and Neversoft scored the license. The game that followed, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater, birthed one of the industry's most successful game franchises. Shortly after securing the Tony Hawk license, Activision gave Spider-Man to Neversoft as well. Luckily for the developer, their newly revamped game engine was made specifically to showcase characters performing death-defying acts of acrobatic audacity. Tony Hawk and Spider-Man were a match made in heaven. In 2000, Activision published Spider-Man for the PlayStation. For the first time, players controlled Spidey in a three-dimensional environment, zipping from floor to ceiling fluidly, beating up on bad guys left and right, and crawling around with intuitive controls. If Spider-Man could do it, chances are players could too. The fact that it featured top-notch vocal talent culled from Spider-Man's animated adventures in the late 90s didn't hurt, nor did its compelling original story. The wealth of comic book minutia like alternate costumes, a what-if mode, and narration from Spider-Man creator Stan Lee was all just icing on the cake. From top to bottom, Spider-Man was a revelation, taking full advantage of this powerful generation of gaming hardware to do something sensational. It was a smash. At the time, reviewers hailed it as the best Spider-Man game, but for many fans, it might have even been the best superhero game, period. Over the next year, Activision seized on the game's tremendous popularity. They tapped their other in-house studios, Edge of Reality, Treyarch, and Vicarious Visions, to make ports for the Nintendo 64, Sega Dreamcast, and Game Boy Color, respectively, to satisfy demand for the webhead. In 2001, Vicarious Visions developed a sequel, Spider-Man 2: Enter Electro, which didn't fare nearly as well as its predecessor. Critics slammed it for buggy controls and camera problems, and Activision didn't bother porting it to any other systems. It didn't matter. Enter Electro's failure was quickly forgotten in the wake of the enormous success of Spider-Man's film debut in 2002. The movie earned $821 million in worldwide box office that year. Suddenly, Spider-Man wasn't simply a popular character, he was a pop culture phenomenon. Since Neversoft was too busy printing money with Tony Hawk sequels for Activision, the publisher assigned the video game tie-in to Treyarch. This new Spider-Man hit the next generation of systems, Sony's PlayStation 2, Microsoft's Xbox, and Nintendo's GameCube, and took full advantage of the greater graphical horsepower those consoles offered. As for gameplay, Treyarch knew better than to mess with success. The studio took most of the gameplay elements from Neversoft's original PlayStation title and simply added content from the movie, including voice work from Tobey Maguire and Willem Dafoe. But they didn't stop there. The game also featured aerial combat sequences in which Spider-Man swung through Manhattan's skyline and chased villains like the Vulture and Green Goblin. Of course, swinging too low meant death, but even that wouldn't be a problem for long. In 2004, Sony Pictures released Spider-Man 2, another blockbuster hit. Many fans thought it had surpassed the original, and just as the movie's sequel improved on the original, Activision and Treyarch's adaptation took everything that made the last game great and made it simply amazing. Spider-Man 2 offered gamers an authentic digital recreation of Manhattan, setting the superhero loose in an open world unparalleled in size and scope. Even more spectacular, for the first time, Spider-Man could descend to street level to fight thugs or web-sling his way through New York skyscrapers. The very act of swinging got a major overhaul too. In past games, Spidey's web simply shot up into the air when he swung. In this new title, though, gamers had to actually hit buildings with each hand's web shooter. The realistic take on Spider-Man's powers and world blew fans away, and the sequel quickly took on mythic status among gamers. It was even listed in a 2010 book, 1001 Video Games You Must Play Before You Die. Pretty high praise for a game based on a comic book character. The brand seemed unstoppable, and a year later in 2005, Activision and Treyarch released Ultimate Spider-Man, a game based on the Ultimate line of comics published by Marvel. The game shared the open-world Manhattan environment and web-slinging gameplay of Spider-Man 2, but featured a cel-shaded visual style. The game was a critical success, but spawned no sequels. Now that Spider-Man had reached such lofty heights as multimedia icon, there was really nowhere left to go but down. Spider-Man 3, based on the 2007 sequel of the same name, was released for the next iteration of consoles, Sony's PlayStation 3, Microsoft's Xbox 360, and the Nintendo Wii. But even though the game was on more powerful hardware, it underwhelmed critics for being too similar to the previous one. And despite the movie franchise's hiatus after the third film, Activision knew they had a guaranteed moneymaker on their hands. New games featuring the character, some fun, some forgettable, kept coming. In 2007, Activision published Spider-Man: Friend or Foe, a kid-friendly adaptation of the movie trilogy developed by Next Level Games. It was built on the premise of Spider-Man teaming up with his villainous rogues gallery in a side-scrolling beat-em-up game. The game earned mixed reviews. In 2008, Treyarch developed Spider-Man: Web of Shadows, which featured a brand new story. Web of Shadows offered players the choice between taking an altruistic path, symbolized by Spidey's classic red and blue uniform, or that of the anti-hero, represented in the game by the black symbiote suit. As players progressed, different powers and new areas of the open-world environment were revealed to them. But despite its unique premise and Metroid-like progression, critics pounced on its lack of polish, poor camera, and graphical glitches. It would be Treyarch's final Spider-Man game. After a two-year break, Activision published Spider-Man: Shattered Dimensions in 2010, developed by in-house studio Beenox. The studio had previously worked on PC and Mac ports of Activision's games, including a few Spider-Man and Tony Hawk titles. The new game featured a brand new story, four different versions of the character based on his many incarnations in the comics, and a voice cast called from the character's many animated series. Instead of the open world gamers adored in 2004, the levels were linear and focused instead on delivering story and action. Critics offered it relatively positive reviews, likely a result of its unique look and having gotten some breathing room since the previous release. Next year, Beenox's Spider-Man: Edge of Time featured only two Spider-Men instead of four, who teamed up on a time travel adventure. Even though it offered a solid original story and excellent voice acting, overall the game was a watered-down version of the adventure that had come before it, keeping gameplay and action repetitive. Mixed reviews once again signaled Spidey overload. Finally, in 2012, Sony Pictures released a cinematic reboot called The Amazing Spider-Man, starring Andrew Garfield and directed by Mark Webb. And once again, Beenox developed a video game tie-in, promising to restore the character back to his former glory with an open-world setting and brand new gameplay mechanics. Only time will tell how history treats this latest installment in the character's vast library of games. It's been 50 years since Stan Lee and Steve Ditko first spun their Spider-Man tale in Amazing Fantasy No. 15. The character has endured every adversity imaginable: teenage heartache, losing loved ones, supervillain chicanery, and even an army of clones, and has come out swinging every time. No matter what form the wall crawler takes in the future, be it in a comic book, a movie, or a video game, fans probably won't be going anywhere. Chances are, they'll always be trapped in his web.